be advised. The opinions and views of the hosts and guests do not reflect those of the station.
Hi, welcome again on this new episode of Gusvis Business Portal, your gateway to opportunities. And this is your host for this segment on Trends Analysis, Toti Casino. Much of what we understand about what's going on with our electoral reform, recently the Committee on Appropriations has allocated a budget of 16 billion pesos for the Commission on Elections for the election come 2013. And much of what we have read in the newspapers, we understand that the commissioners and bank are considering to pursue the purchases of the present count optical scanning or the PICOS machines from Smartmatic. What we have here, though, we have a former candidate running as a representative in the province of Biliran, who himself has filed a protest against the outcome using the PICOS machines. It's none other than the former representative of the Biliran province, Congressman Glenn Chong. Welcome to the program,
Thank you, Congressman. Thank you, Tuti, and to our listeners, thank you very much.
Now, quickly, what has your incumbency done in Biliran? How many terms have you served in Biliran?
Actually, I first ran in 2007. I was virtually nobody when I first ran, and I won against the patriarch of the ruling family in my province.
Are you a family of politicians?
No, I'm the only one who entered
politics.
So
what is your background? How did you get into politics?
I'm a CPA lawyer. I was engaged in running my family's businesses before I was thrust into politics. Mm-hmm. The events of 2006 actually thrust me in because our former governor, the lone opposition in Biliran at that time, was shot to death in Cebu City in front of his wife on September 6.
This was
September 7, 2006.
This was the former governor.
The former governor of Biliran, the lone political opposition in Biliran at that time.
Okay, and he goes by the name of
Attorney Danilo Parilla.
Okay.
He was shot to death in front of his wife when he was disembarking from a ship from Naval, the provincial capital, to Cebu City.
What was the status of that investigation?
Of course, the assassin was formerly the bodyguard of the ruling family. If you look at the footage of ABS-CBN, he was accosted with an ID from the provincial government of Biliran at that time, but of course he's already dead by now. He died three months before the elections in 2010.
He was an incumbent.
While detained. He was the former governor at the time.
Former already, in the lone opposition.
But he had a pending protest as mayor of the provincial capital against the father of this political dynasty that controls Biliran at this time.
I see. Mm-hmm. And then when you ran for Congress in 2007,
siya yung nakalaban ko, the father.
Okay, and you won.
I won by 5,800 plus votes. That's about roughly 7%.
Okay, under your incumbency, what have you accomplished?
Tuti, I ran under extraordinary circumstances at that time. The people didn't know me. So ang ginawa ko, I wrote a letter to them and I put my promises there. And I signed my name.
Okay.
Siguro, this is the only time you have heard a politician putting his promises on paper and signing it with his own signature.
And where did you have this published?
I gave it to the people.
How?
Parang pamphlet.
A pamphlet.
I gave it to them.
All right.
There's a letter there. I addressed it to them. Mm-hmm. And then the promises. Actually, I promised them three things. Public infrastructure, education, and health. Because these are the pillars of a strong economy, as far as I believe.
Okay.
So, when I was incumbent, dalawa yung signature project na ginawa namin. I have to focus on education because I always believe that education is the greatest equalizer between a poor kid and a rich kid.
Right.
The odds are really stacked against the poor.
What's the population size of Biliran?
Roughly less than 200,000.
It's an island province.
Yes, it's an island province.
Covering how many municipalities?
Covering 8 municipalities. It's roughly the size of Singapore. A little less than Singapore. And it's a good way to experiment in public policy.
So you had this priority with infrastructure?
Yes, infrastructure. We have to finish the concreting of the circumferential road. my predecessor, all of them from the same family, left me with roughly 50 plus kilometers of bad roads. I left them with 20 kilometers na lang yung natira. Because as far as we are concerned, they cemented 32 kilometers in 12 years. We cemented 31 kilometers in 3 years. So meaning, we lost 9 years.
All right.
Na walang nangyari dun sa karsada.
Okay.
And aside from that, the other one is yung focus namin sa education. We bought 15, actually we structured it in 3.
Uh-huh.
Yung mga elementary, binibigyan namin ng some sort of support every year. So nung first year ko, I was able to give them 26,000. Lahat ng mga elementary students ko, 26,000 school bags.
Mm-hmm.
Which I had manufactured in China kasi 120 pesos lang FOB Biliran na. Landed cost na yung 120 from Shenzhen to Biliran, 120 pesos per piece. So I had 26,000 made and then binigay ko sa mga bata. Then the next year binigay ko sa mga elementary students ko is school uniforms. Yung mga school uniforms, it costed mga something like 200 pesos per set. So yun yung binigay ko, 26,000 of them. Supposedly this after ng 2010 elections, what I promised them was school shoes. But of course, we didn't make it because of the speakers, and that's what we're going to discuss in a while.
Right, right.
Aside from that, yung sa high school, we bought 14 school buses, air-conditioned tourist coaches. Pinipick up namin yung mga bata from their barangays every day, Mondays to Fridays. From their barangays, we send them to school, and then back in the evening, binabalik namin sila sa mga barangay nila. These 14 buses carry between 6,000 to 7,000 students per day.
Wow.
At a cost of roughly 1 peso and 66 centavos per student. Back and forth na yun.
How did you able to bring the cost so low?
Because a bus carries 54 passengers.
Right, okay.
Pero these are big ones. Yung mga adult. When you factor in
the size.
Physical size of the high school students, you actually sit more.
Okay.
You actually, mas maraming, as much as 120 yung papasok doon. They will have to stand na lang yung iba eh. And then we use this bus system to instill also discipline because we have rules. You have 3 minutes to load and unload. So meaning to say, pagdaan ng bus doon sa barangay, sa waiting shed nila, dapat nakalinya na sila. Girls first, boys last. So that when the bus gets in, there's also a schedule doon sa waiting shed. Kung anong oras dadaan yung bus dyan. So give and take 10 minutes, you have to be there earlier. You have to line. Because when the bus doors open, you have to load within 3 minutes. Because we have to follow the schedule. The buses run at 5:30. By 7:30, all the buses are already in school.
Do they go far distance?
Yes. One bus can go as far as 4 municipalities. Then another bus goes the other way.
Oh,
we follow the system in Hong Kong, the bus system in Hong Kong.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I have my program manager doon how the bus should run. And the bus had run for more than 2 years na walang problema.
Okay, and about the maintenance of those buses?
These were all funded by the Priority Development Assistance Fund ng congressman.
Okay.
It costed at about 10 million pesos a year. Siguro this time mga 15 million na. But the buses are no longer running at this time.
The
present administration stopped it.
Right.
Yung bagong representative, hindi niya nilagyan ng fund yung school bus to run. But the assets are preserved because we have a pending protest. In case we get back, we will be able to run the...
And that protest of yours is pertaining to the efficiency of the PICOS machine.
Yes, we have factual basis naman to and documents to prove that something's really wrong with this PICOS. And considering na maliit lang yung hinahabol namin, 361 votes.
That is the numbers that the opposition won against you.
Yes, the marginal difference.
Right, right.
The other project we have, Tuti, is yung Strategic Health Initiative.
Okay.
We bought a mobile clinic, and then I assembled a team of 32 doctors, dentists, and nurses, including medical and dental support staff. Meron pa akong PT doon.
Okay.
May hilot din.
Okay.
Because Strategic Health Initiative nga, kaya we encompass everything.
All right.
And then this system goes to the barangays every Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays, 4 times a week. One day, one barangay. And we were able to serve in the first 3 months something like 35,000 people.
That kind of model, would that translate better if considering that there's this present program by the current administration, the conditional cash transfer?
We focus on health. The conditional transfer could be used siguro in many other ways like sustenance nila. Sa amin is, ang title nga ng project namin is Strategic Health Initiative. We rather bring preventive medicine right to the barangays rather than them going to the hospital.
Okay, because the conditions for that is they will give that to the parents so that the children can go to work.
Can go to school.
Right, right. But in this case, you already provided the provisions to bring the students.
Yes, we have to get the students in their barangay, right. Send them to school, and then go back sa barangay at no cost to them. We estimated the savings for the parents would be something like between 4,000 to 12,000
per student per year.
How
did you arrive to that savings?
The maximum kasi, ang sinasakyan ng mga bata in many instances dun sa probinsya is yung habal-habal. Yung motor, na as many as 5 or 6 students in one motorcycle, which is prone to accident.
Yeah.
And then, as far as I know, 900 ata yung pinakamahal or 1,000 per month yung bayad nila. And there are 10 months in a year.
Wow.
Na school, sa isang school year, there are 10 months.
Okay.
So, roughly, 10,000 pesos if malayo ka. Pag malapit naman, siguro mga 4,000 pesos yung pinakamahal.
That disenfranchised those habal-habal operators?
No, we explained to them. I understand. I have to explain it to them.
Okay.
And sabi ko nga sa kanya, I promised you this. I'll keep it that way.
Okay.
And it's ano naman, Toti, it's political will.
Yeah.
If you have no political will, you will not get things moving.
Right.
Walang mangyayari doon sa project mo.
Uh-huh.
Walang mangyayari doon sa program mo if you're not able to implement it because you lack political will.
Okay.
I explained it to them. One time I was in a barangay, someone, a habal-habal driver was there shouting at me. I was in the stage. He was shouting at me because he was angry at me.
Correct.
And then, sinabi ko sa kanila, I have to explain it to them. In the end, he was the first one to clap. Pero ang ginawa ko rin sa kanila, meron din kaming rules. If the child resides within 1.5 kilometers from the school, hindi namin pick up. So as not to disturb the existing transport network. Kasi maliit na lang yung gastos nila 1.5 kilometers nila. But if the child lives 10 kilometers away from the school,
that's something
you have to really save. I remember one time, the reason why I really had this project implemented, I was in a barangay once at 2 a.m. I went out of that barangay kasi fiesta.
Uh-oh.
I saw in the waiting shed mga bata na naka-uniform at 2 o'clock in the morning. Then I asked my staff, tanungin mo nga kung anong ginagawa nila rito at 2 o'clock in the morning. They were waiting for the bus going to Manila because ang binibigay nila dun sa conductor, pang-iosi lang. And they will sleep for the rest of the evening dun sa school.
Okay.
So they, as early as 2 a.m., they wait for the bus. Pagdating nila dun sa kabilang bayan, dun na sila matutulog sa paralan. What would you get out of that? What kind of education are we going to give these kids? What kind of future are we going to give them?
Okay.
And that's why it really pushed me to implement the system, although I know the malaking sakit ng ulo. But we partnered with a private institution na or private group na sila yung nagpapatakbo. And we also had 3 inspectors to inspect the buses one by one as we operate. And then, meron pa silang conductor sa loob.
Okay.
May steward sila sa loob.
Right.
And naka-uniforme yun lahat.
Okay. Aside from your contributions to your community, what else have you contributed to the Congress?
I authored 5 bills. One is I converted my state college into a university because yun lang naman yung institution of higher learning doon. And then I authored also 3 specialized national high schools. I wanted to increase the number of high schools kasi.
Okay.
Specialized national high schools because one is for culture and the arts. I'm a patron of culture and the arts. The other one is information and communication technology. And the other one is for science.
What was the status that happened to them?
They've been implemented already this time because they were all signed into law.
All 5 bills?
5 bills. The other one is I converted my small island municipality into national road kasi maliit lang yun dun eh. And I wanted to give them a better... That's part of the
program. Now, with all this breakthrough that you have accomplished, how come you lost? And we'll get to that topic after this break. You're tuning in here on the Business Portal for this segment on Trends and Analysis. And our guest is from the province of Biliran, none other than the former Congressman, Representative Glenn Chong. And we're here to discuss more about the concerns on the PICOS, its issues, and other matters. Do stay tuned for more information. here on the Business Portal for this segment on Trends and Analysis. Your host, Tori Casino. And with us is our guest from the province of Biliran, the former representative himself, who has an electoral protest, none other than Glenn Chong. So, Congressman, you have this protest pending with
the House of Representatives Electoral Tribunal, and there's also one pending before the COMELEC for the governor and several also the mayors.
Ah, you're not alone.
Hindi lang ako.
The whole party.
Kasi ang natalo kasi sa amin is the congressman, the governor, and all of the mayors except one. So isa lang yung
which
nakapasok.
Parties do you all come from?
Lakas Kampi.
Lakas Kampi, okay. So what were your petitions in HRET regarding your case?
We are asking the HRET for a manual revision of the ballots, of course subject to the rules, no? With all due respect to them. But we presented to them the evidence like what I have, I'm about to show you. It might not be really clear from doon sa scan documents, but we're hoping that we could bring this before the Senate committee so that this can be expounded. And
okay, so what were your findings?
Actually, we have a lot. Actually, doon sa committee hearing ni former Representative Chudoro Loxin, I actually submitted, in-outline ko doon, ito yung mga kasalanan ng BEI, ito yung mga kasalanan ng election officers, ng provincial election supervisors, with respect to the manner by which the PCOS was handled.
Okay, so aside
from that, the technical side, because actually dito, we're talking of automated elections for the very first time, so that everybody is nangangapa.
Correct.
We don't know exactly.